Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
At this time, I'm going to call on Commissioner Sutton to have our invocation, please.
Yes, ma'am. If we can take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Thank you for another new season. Be with us worldwide as we try to do the things that are pleasing to you. Please be with those in the Gulf. Please try to help us get that disaster solved. Be with our soldiers worldwide as we try to go against people who forever would try to do us harm. Our Heavenly Father, please help us all to realize that the path that we choose in life, whether it be here in our state, nationally, or global, are the paths that will either take us down the roads to success or down the roads to ruination. Please help us to determine the difference. Amen.
Okay. Sherry, just said, is everybody that signed up, are you going to talk about the public hearing, or do you have something else? Margaret, what do you want to talk about?
I want to talk about what they're trying to do for our sheriff out in Alamance County.
Well, then I'll let you come up and make your comment. Come on.
Ma'am?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right now. It's the it's right public now. Comment time, girl.
You're on the spot.
Well, the reason that I asked that is because we do have a public hearing, and so I will call out your name, and if it's for the public hearing, then just wait till I get through the public hearing. But you're good. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm Margaret Dammer. And what I'd like to say is that I feel like it should be published in the Times News who is filed the grievance against the Sheriff Department. Now, it's been about a year since they went through all this. And look what it cost Alamance County, plus the time that it takes the Sheriff Department to go through all that. And the taxpayers are paying for it. And not only that, the government's I'm just getting over pneumonia.
Okay.
I've been real sick for about 4 or 5 weeks.
Paying the people to come down here, right?
The Department of Justice.
Paying the Department of Justice.
Yeah. Which, to me, I think Alamance County, the people in Alamance County and our county commissioners should stand behind Terry Johnson, whether you like him or you don't like him. It's time that all this stopped, because nothing else has changed since the last time they did that. So I think we should tell them where to go. And I can tell you, I can tell them.
We wish we could.
I mean, really, seriously. It's time all
this junk
stopped.
The sheriff is fanning, by the way. Thank you. Thank you so much for
your
comments.
And I could have said a whole lot more, but my voice is
back together. We appreciate you coming.
We appreciate it.
Yeah, I've been real sick. And okay. Next time I'll say more.
Okay. Ms. Rottenberry, is yours on the budget or?
On the budget.
Okay, if you'll just wait till I open that for public comments, okay?
I'll try my best.
Okay. George Adams?
Budget.
Okay. Kim Steele?
Budget.
Ed Hsu?
Budget.
And is that Dale Simmons?
Yeah.
Are you budgets or something else? Come right on that.
Okay.
I live down in the, I guess you'd say, southwest corner of Alamance County.
Yes, sir.
And my farm, or my son's farm's in all three counties, Guilford, Randolph, and Alamance. And I brought y'all a thing that stated all four counties were mounted on the same stump. Well, Guilford and Randolph County has established a boundary. When they did, Alamance County's boundary established right there with it. It's not 450 feet over in Alamance County that they've got by with for 61 years collecting taxes off of 2 acres and 1/7 or 30 feet for 61 years that you're losing money on. And all you got to do is ask Mr. Dan Ingalls to help you get straightened out. These surveyors, I don't know if they're in Guilford County's back pocket or what, but they told me I didn't have nothing to or say about it. But I went to court with Guilford County 26 years ago, and I won, which this anyway, the court in Raleigh said that my property was not in Guilford County, affirmed and affirmed. And they have not released me to Alamance County. One tax collector brought me a paper to sign telling me that if I'd sign that paper and anybody else on that county line road would sign it, he'd release us to Alamance County. Mm-hmm. They fired him. And which I thought, well, I just don't think a county is above the law.
Oh, no, agree.
And that's about all I've got to say.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Simmons.
Mm-hmm. I was mistaken. I wanted to speak on the sales tax thing.
Okay, well, come on up, Minnie. So you don't want to talk about the
No, I was looking down here. Okay. But I understand election year, and you're not personally wanting to tackle property tax. And I hate that the state ever made this end run around the way to tax. I asked you not to approve this thing to put a referendum on the ballot because there are so many people with so much to gain that it may slip under the radar. In other words, I'm certain that if every single person in Alamance County was to vote today, I don't care if they're 1/8 cent, that it would go down. But the trouble is, those are not the people that vote. There's a lot of uninformed people miss these off-year elections, miss these little referendum things, and don't know the issue. If you got to have the money, go ahead and take and swallow your election worries and voted yourself through property tax. Don't use this backdoor thing the state has came up with and hope that county employees, people with interest in getting funded, you know, getting more funded, have a vested interest in these dollars you're going to be taking, carrying it over at the polls for you. They may well do it. They very well could do it. It's got to where it looks like everybody's employed by government one way or another. But there's still those other people that it will be taken from. And I wish you just apparently have two. If one of you will swing, we won't have to worry with this mess. One of you stand up.
Thank you. Thank you, Ed. Okay, this time
you have one more public.
Okay.
He's standing in the back of the room.
Mr. Aldridge, you want to speak?
Yes, Madam Chair.
And you remember you have 3 minutes, sir.
My name is Kerry Allred. I realize I have 3 minutes.
Okay.
One thing I like coming down here is that I don't have to wear a coat and tie like I did in Raleigh. It's not a requirement. But I'm here to ask you not to put a referendum on the ballot to raise the sales tax. A sales tax is punitive. Eddie, it's going to hurt the home builders. The home builders are going to have to pay more sales tax on the materials they buy. It's going to hurt the retailers in this county. They'll go to Virginia on big-ticket items and buy big-ticket items rather than buy it in Alamance County. Or they'll go to Tennessee. It is regressive. Now, maybe you don't care that it hurts the poor people. Maybe you can say, well, that's the fair way to tax people. You know, some people think it's a way to get at the some people think it's a way to get at a particular part of the community that they don't think are paying their fair share of the taxes. But what they don't realize is they are hurting the economy by raising. If you raise the sales tax, you hurt the sales, and then ultimately you get less revenue. So the sales tax is regressive. The only people who want it are special interest groups who want more taxpayers' money. And you need to be down here thinking about the taxpayers of this county who are footing the bills who are not asking you to give them more money for their budget or for their particular tax break for their particular group. And I can tell you a lot of places that I think the county budget ought to be reduced, and one place is that in the administration of the schools. The schools don't need any more money. They're the ones that are going to benefit from the quarter cent increase if it passes. They don't need any more money. The superintendent should not be making $185,000 a year. The assistant superintendent shouldn't be making $120,000 a year. The superintendent said that the assistant superintendent's position was the most important position in the system. Well, then I say, let's get rid of the superintendent. And plus, there's about six others over there that are making $100,000 a year in the administrative department. And you know what? I don't mean this as anything personal against Ronnie Wall. I like him fine as a person. But if he's got time to serve on the State Board of Transportation as the mayor of Burlington and as the superintendent of construction for the Burlington City Schools, I don't think he's worth $100,000 a year. He can't be earning that kind of money if he's doing all that work. And I've always worked two or three jobs in my life. But I'm asking you, don't put a referendum on the ballot to increase the sales tax, because it is an insult. It's an insult to the taxpayers. Beverly Perdue and the legislature increased the sales tax last year. I didn't vote for it. We've got enough taxes. Enough is enough. When will you get it?
Thank you. Okay, at this time I'm going to close the public comments, and I will open the public hearing on our budget ordinance. I will call on you. You want to make a comment first?
Good evening, Madam Chair and Board of Commissioners. This is kind of rehashing what we have been doing since February. If you remember, we started in February looking at the budget, looking at this current year budget, and looking at how we can make cuts in the current year. We've done that, and I think we've done a good job, thanks to the department heads working with us on that. But we started this year in the hole. And we had a clear directive from this board, was no new tax increase. So again, just to give you a quick overview, at our April 5th meeting, we started at $10.2 million in the hole on our current budget, on our proposed 10-11 budget. But again, in working with department heads and working at trying to come up with different revenue options, we do have a general fund budget recommended at $130,752,420. And again, the tax rate is recommended to be at 52 cents per hundred. And again, that's the same as this year. We are using almost $5 million in non-recurring revenue to balance the budget. It's one of the things I want to make sure that we're fully aware. We've tried to really reduce our fund balance usage. We've kind of filled some holes with some interest money. We're trying to fill some holes with some lottery money. But we have $5 million in non-reoccurring revenue. So that's something that hopefully through growth, hopefully through sales tax increase, it will not be as large next year. But as we talked about before, that's the bear in the woods for next year. Again, one of the directives this board gave staff was to look at our fund balance. This year, we're projecting to use $1.4 million. That seems like a lot of money. However, $400,000 of that is budgeted for the ADM match. And again, we'll get with that when we talk about the school funding options. But that's money that we will get back. We will get that match back. $700,000 of that $1.4 million, we can save with furloughs. And we've talked about the furlough issues for emergency and non-emergency personnel, and I'll have that broken down in a second. But if you take that $1.1 million out, we're really only using $300,000 in fund balance. But again, if you look at this year's budget, we've projected to use $2.9 million in fund balance. Any questions on that?
Okay.
The big issue that's been in papers, been on our employees' minds, has been on, I think, the board's minds as well, has been the furlough issue. Again, as we talked about, 3 days for employees. And again, that's just basically, one of the things we're looking at along with this as far as giving something back to our employees is 3 bonus days. That is basically 3 days paid time off. Then we have furloughs. That is unpaid time off. We're looking at 5 days for non-emergency personnel, which will be tied to holidays, and 3 days for emergency personnel, which will be floating throughout the year. Anytime between July 1 and June 30th, that time would have to be taken. Again, as we talked about, we have budgeted full salaries in our budget. Any savings will be a less reduced usage of fund balance. One of the questions that have been asked, is about benefits. Benefits will still be paid fully. Under general statute, you cannot reduce, through furloughs, you cannot reduce benefits. So retirement and 401k will still be paid at their normal rate and their normal accumulation. Again, the only reduction in that is pay. Again, as we talked about, the 3 days floating throughout the year for emergency, and there's how we are looking at tying the furlough days to holidays. Again, probably a big change from our last meeting has been to talk about our request of the school board to use some of the ADM funds. Originally, we suggested that we should be able to use some of the ADM funds to help pay for our shortfall in sales tax, which covered the debt service for what we have for the school system. One of the issues that we also had, we had some leftover bond money. And there's $1.7 million in interest in bond money that's just sitting there. That has not been allocated and has not been allocated to any project. In working with the school system, the county will use $1.7 million in bond interest funds. We originally requested to use $1 million of ADM funding, and that was a net million. Gross would have been $1.4 million, but it would have been a net million. The school has requested that for this year, we didn't budget any match for ADM funds. However, you can use ADM funds for technology without a match. And they would like to ask that we release $1.2 million. I want to make sure that figure is right. For technology, is it
Stonebridge one? Is here, but I think it is.
I believe that 1.2 for technology?
Yes.
All right. 1.2 for ADM funds for technology, and that would be released this year for the 9-10 budget with no match. The schools also request to use some ADM funds for next year for $1.6 million. We would budget $400,000 of that match, but again, we would get that back. Where we would get the net $1 million is from their lottery proceeds, and again, that net $1 million would go to our debt service for the schools. This is a little bit different than we talked about at our last meeting, but the numbers still remain the same, and I appreciate Dr. Bridges and the school board working with us on this to really getting to our ultimate goal on that, which was to use $1 million from some of their pots of money towards debt service. And I think we've accomplished that with this. And since the last meeting, that's all I had. One thing I did want to mention about the budget that we have not talked about, there is one tax increase in the budget, the fire district tax for Hall River. They have requested that that go from 10.5 cents to 13.5 cents. So that was a request that is in the budget. It is in the ordinance. No other fire departments have asked for an increase for this year.
How did they justify that request?
Not a lot of justification, just a request saying they needed the additional 3 cents.
They did have to pay for their 800 megahertz equipment. They paid for it in Hall River out of their money. I do know that. And the sheriff knows that as well. So we didn't pay for any of their 800 megahertz equipment. So that might be part of it. And I'm not saying it is, but I just know that happened, okay?
That was the only fire department increase that we had this year.
And that other thing that I asked you to say?
One of the things that we talked about with respect to furloughs, and again, maybe a suggestion to kind of help balance out the furlough issue is if we could go back maybe in January, we look at seeing where revenues are. If we don't need the final 2 days of furlough, if sales tax and growth has picked up and our revenue projections are above where we're projecting them to be now, maybe we can come back to the board at that time and say, with your blessing, we would like to not require the additional 2 days of furlough January 1. But we should be able to have a better feel for that in January than we do now. The other issue is that is, you know, with respect to any salary adjustments, cost of living raises, is that we relook at that possibly January 1 as well.
I've had several phone calls about the furloughs, and they wanted to know if they could take the furloughs through November and not let it go into December because of the Christmas holidays or the Christmas.
Well, we looked at that. We did a survey of county employees to see would they rather have the December furlough or the November furlough. It was 50-50. Basically, and I asked the department heads at a department head meeting, and the overwhelming majority was to stay with the Christmas furlough day. Okay. So it was kind of a 50-50. One of the things we're going to try to do, though, with our December pay is try to pay it closer to the 25th than we have in the past. So I think we paid that historically around the 18th. Then that gives a long time between the 25th of January, but we're going to try to move that closer to the 25th of December.
Okay.
Can we go back to the fire departments? We get blasted quite often that we blanket approve the fire taxes in our budget process and we don't know much about what their budgets are. We don't know much about what their reserve accounts are. I mean, so much as even years ago, one was even investigated for some poor investment strategy. On the Hall River situation, does the city of Hall River give money as well to the fire department there?
Yeah, they do.
I thought they did.
And their budget is not good. Hall River's budget is not good this year. They're scraping the bottom of the barrel like we are.
That's the highest tax rate, so, for a volunteer fire department that we've got.
I don't know what the rest are.
It is the highest.
Yeah, I think it is. And do we know what their budget, what their balance, what their reserve accounts are, or...
No, sir. We haven't, since I've been here, there's not really a process that we've had of looking at. It's just basically been looking at their requests and then submitting it to the board.
What most people don't realize is that each fire department has their own board.
Right.
And they approve or didn't, but it's more rubber stamp than it is analytical debate as far as I'm concerned. And somebody here from, you're with Fire and Safety, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, have you been out to their...
I have not. I'm not able to speak on their department.
See, their equipment. One department can have excessive equipment and equipment that's not necessary, and then some may be doing just fine. I'd like to see us in this upcoming fiscal year look at some process of analyzing their equipment, at least having some checks and balances of what's going on. And because I've had people say to me, if we had more of a checks and balances system, maybe that investment situation, I think there were some criminal charges filed in that, weren't there?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm not. It was a pretty heavy duty deal. And I just hate to, sit here and allow a 3-cent tax increase without knowing more than I know. Can that be pulled out and voted on separately? I don't see why it can't be.
I think we can. We could separate it from the budget ordinance and relook at that at the 21st.
I'll make a motion that we do that.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd second
that. Yeah. That's
good. I think they'd probably get good reason.
Right.
But we need to find out.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, especially since it came in the 11th hour.
I have a motion, but I don't know.
I think
we just.
She's got a second.
Yeah.
I've got their budget request here, and the three things they mention personnel, increase in insurance cost, retirement contribution increase, and 3% salary increase. And they've got capital outlay, one-time cost of purchase of equipment and training materials, and then they've got debt service, which is the payment on new fire truck and 800 megahertz radio equipment.
Yeah.
So that's the three things, the three main reasons why they're asking for the increase.
I like to still have more time to look at it.
Okay.
Well, we need to move on
that motion. Yeah, we need to vote on it. So all in favor say aye.
Aye.
If there's any more questions, I'll go sit out. Okay.
Any more questions for Ms. Trinicat?
Yeah, one more.
Yeah.
Okay, how many vacancies do we now have in this fiscal year? This fiscal year?
Sure.
Currently. Current vacancies, yeah. I don't know the exact number. I would say maybe six. There are a few of them that are, we're still doing the 90-day freeze on, and right. So they're not open yet. And then I think we have three or four that are posted. So
is there anything in the upcoming fiscal 2010-2011 of an anticipated level of vacancies?
Well, one of the things that we are going to relook at, we talked about as part of the process, was looking at early retirement and see if there are any takers on that. And if there are takers, you know, we would look at how we could reorganize and try not to fill those type positions.
I'm talking about just normal attrition or vacancies or...
Turnover, I think it's been fairly steady. You know, we haven't seen a spike either way. We are still holding, you know, it's kind of been an internal policy that we've looked at is positions that do come vacant, we're having a 90-day freeze on, unless it is a department that is kind of mandatory that they fill somebody, or if it's a grant-filled position. You know, we're kind of more lenient on that, but we try to hold off as long as we can to fill the positions to see if we can do without.
Turnover rate for the county is what? What percentage would you say?
A little over 5%.
All right, so that's roughly 45 to 50 people. Yeah, and if you don't fill those 45 to 50, that's a lot of money that might help along with the furlough issue as well as, okay, I just want to make sure we get that number out there.
Any other questions?
Okay. At this time, I'm going to go ahead and the people that signed up, I'll start with Mr. Rottenberry. If you want to come up and talk about the budget, please.
Madam Chairman, may I stand right here?
Yes, sir.
My problem with the budget, I don't agree with the furloughs. back when you voted to approve this $10 million projects, remodeling, different things, I noticed in the paper this past week, Kern's Construction was out at Cedar Rock Park replacing windows at the Garrett House. I don't understand why we need to pay an architect to look after a job like that. When he gets through, he's going to collect over $500,000 from the Alamance County. Our maintenance department should have been able to go out there and replace those windows. Hell, I can't see them, but what I and I'd go out there and replace them. And I don't understand why our maintenance department couldn't do a lot of this work. And Eddie, you know yourself, in that $10 million, you and Bill, of all people, know there's a lot of stuff that the maintenance department could have done. You've got an extra inspector out there that's retired from the county. Why do you need him? You're paying an architect 10%, 15% of what he's collecting. I don't understand it. We could have saved enough money by looking after some of this stuff ourselves. You would be furloughing people. Mr. Burgess stood right there and said it's going to increase the taxes 2 cents if you approve this. Mr. Sutton said he would not vote for it. If that was in there, he reworded it, came back to the podium, omitted the 2 cent tax increase, and it was approved. Am I wrong? Don't think so. He told you what was happening.
But in my opinion, he used a little threat, because I think he said at the time, if you don't approve this tonight, the cost may go up. How's the cost going to go up? Construction workers don't have jobs. Construction companies are going out of business. I really and truly think we could have saved more than enough money by not approving that $10 million, and it's too late now. But I think we could have saved more than enough money out of that $10 million. You wouldn't have to furlough anybody, and you wouldn't have to be adding a sales tax. And I, for one, think the sales tax is probably the most fair tax you could put on, because everybody's got to pay it. But I think we need to still, before you approve a budget, I think you need to look at some of the people that you've got out here working that don't need to be working, instead of furloughing some of these little people in the county that don't make $20,000 a year. We always pick on the little man. It's time to stop.
That's right.
Thank you. Mr. Adams?
My name's George Adams, and I'm here pitch it for William A. Curran. She was going to come tonight, but she had a slight accident. She won't be around for a while. Her main reason for being here was to speak about out against any tax increases for those of us who can least afford them, as the senior citizens. That's all I got to say.
Okay, thank you. Kim Steele.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak before this commission. My name is Kim Steele. My husband Tom and I are the proud parents of a rising junior and a rising fifth grader. I am the immediate past president of the PTA at Smith Elementary and am the incoming president of the PTSO at Williams High School. I am also the incoming chair of VOICE, Volunteers of Individual Children Everywhere. I have worked closely with Dr. Bridges through VOICE, understand his commitment and vision for excellence, and have seen how these expectations have carried over directly into the classroom. I come before you this evening because I'm requesting that the mandatory portion of our budget be funded, and am greatly concerned about the possible cuts you are considering to the county funds allocated to the Alamance Burlington school system. The children of Alamance County are our greatest resource. When funding our education system is a primary focus in preparing the budget for Alamance County, the message is sent that education is a priority. Think of the potential that could be realized if we fully invest in the education of the children in our community. Not only would we equip our children for the future, we would give those who are charged with the responsibility of economic development in our community a higher quality workforce, which is an essential tool when attracting business and industry. By investing in education, you are investing in our community and in its future. It is essential that the facilities of the Alamance Burlington school system be maintained, and only through this budget can they. It is vital that a long-range plan be established for funding basic maintenance, such as painting, repairs, and replacing worn-out equipment in our schools, and for new construction that is needed, spelling out a specific time frame for those things to be completed. If we do not fund basic maintenance, the integrity of these structures of our schools will be compromised. Without adequate facilities, how do we educate our children? By developing a long-range plan for not only maintenance but new construction, we are creating a vision for what our schools can and should be, and budgeting to make these plans a reality. I have witnessed many positive changes in our schools that have improved the educational opportunities for our children, but we can do more. I want Alamance County to be competitive locally and even globally. The way to make this a reality is to equip our children with the best education possible. This can be achieved if we ensure that our facilities are maintained, plan for the long range, and make sure that teachers have the necessary tools with which to work. By providing our teachers with these tools, our students will learn more, achieve at a higher level, resulting in a brighter future for all in our community. Make education a priority, fully fund our school system, Our future depends on it.
Okay, at this time, I will recognize you if you will raise your hand and would like to speak on the budget. I will recognize you.
Yes, ma'am.
If you'll come up and speak your name. I'm sorry. If you'll come up.
Can't double dip.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. My name is Allison Gant. I am the Executive Director of Alamance Citizens for Education. It is unlikely that I will change your minds tonight on the decisions of the budget that have been placed before you by the county manager. So I've decided to take a little different approach and talk about the future. As we all know, a community is only as strong as the leadership that leads it, and the citizens must take a vested interest in its community to move it into a competitive, forward position for business, industry, education, and ultimately a high quality of living. I recently read a book called The Ten Commandments of Community Leadership. This was put out by Washington State, two authors, Foreman and Harvey, which can apply to anyone, whether you're in business, public or private, or you're in public office. Each one of these commandments set forth the principle by which to lead and govern, kind of like a toolkit, if you would, to creating a successful community. Now, the goal was to help the leaders create a healthy future for their community. So what I'd like to do, although time does not permit for me to go to the bullet points under each commandment, I would like to just run through those briefly and note that each one would begin with thou shalt. Create a vision for the future, develop a strategic plan, build a sustainable economy for the next generation, seek public and private partnerships, invest in education and training, promote respect, demonstrate a high standard of ethical behavior, value history, art, and culture, prepare for a global environment, and develop future leaders. Recently, I presented this presentation to a group of Alamance County leaders. The report card, if you will say, reflected this. They gave our county 4 B's, 3 C's, 3 C minuses, which is an overall C average. Now, I'm not sure of you, but I don't want my community to be known as just average by its business leaders. The teachers in our community strive each and every day for their students to show excellence. They expect far more than a C from their students. Shouldn't our community strive for Alamance County to be excellent in all of its categories, including these 10 commandments that I just mentioned? Is a C good enough for us in Alamance County? I personally don't think so. So as we look to the future of Alamance County, I challenge you to think about the responsibility you have as elected officials to this community, taking these commandments into consideration, and commit to putting aside your personal biases, any old history, and above all, political gain. I'm not just advocating for public education, but for a success of Alamance County. A community's future is shaped by the attitudes of its citizens, including its youth, and the youth of today are tomorrow's leaders, and they must be prepared. Our own governor stated, North Carolina's public schools are the backbone of this state's economic future. If we fail to meet the needs of our students today, we not only fail those students, but the communities and our state's future of its health. Our state needs to resize school funding, be prepared for the federal stimulus money to go away, and decide on our priorities. If we want to take North Carolina back to its resounding years, While we wait for the recovery, we cannot wait to fund our schools. Schools must be funded first. The difference in a striving community and a thriving community is the leadership that exists. Is this leadership in this commission placing Alamance County in a strategic forward moving way, or are we just status quo? Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Okay. Mr. Aubrey can raise his hand.
My name is Kerry Allred. I served 4 years as a state senator, 10 years as a county commissioner, and 14 and a half years as a state representative. I know what I'm talking about. You do not have to adopt a budget tonight. You do not have to adopt a budget before July the 1st. You can operate under state law on an interim budget while you find the places that can be cut to reduce the property tax rate and not ask the people to, or try to run some ruse. R-U-S-E, a ruse, is a big lie on the people that you're going to reduce property taxes if they pass a quarter cent sales tax. You know, in the 10 years I was a county commissioner, I heard the same song and dance every year from the school board and from people, the professional educators. They say the same thing every year. They may as well put it on a broken a record and bring it down here and play the same thing every year. Everybody cannot be above average. Look at the money that you have spent in this county on education, and where has it gotten us? It has gotten us to the point that we need more money. Now, I'll tell you one thing. We certainly didn't need a the school board's getting plenty of money. They're not spending it properly. I told you about the administrative salaries. You can either bite the bullet or not. Maybe you got some guts. I don't know. We don't need a career and technical education center. We've already got Alamance Community College. That was a stupid decision by the school board to waste money. It will do nothing, even in the words of the superintendent, it will do nothing to reduce the overcrowding. And Southern Alamance certainly has overcrowding. Now, I don't care whether you like my, you know, what I've got to say or not, but somebody has got to say it. Somebody has got to stand up for the people who don't have the courage or the education or the whatever you want to call it, chutzpah. That's a Jewish word for it, okay? To come down here and tell you to quit catering to special interest groups. Farmers get more tax breaks than any other people in the world. They do not pay property taxes on their farmland. They may be big farm owners. Hey, I own five pieces. I got interest in five pieces of property. By some standards, I'm a big property owner. But not by Curry standards, of course. I'm not a big property owner. But farmers get tax breaks, no sales tax on items they purchase for the farm, no sales tax on building materials. They do not have to pay building permits. They could actually build a building and buy materials and live in it and call it a farm building and not pay sales tax. They can buy dirt bikes and ATVs and John Deere Gators and not pay sales tax because they're claiming that's used for use on the farm. Now, I love farmers.
Sounds like it.
I love teachers. By the way, I'm trying to get a grapevine growing because I want to start a grape orchard, because you only have to have 5 acres of land in order to get reduced property value when you're running a grape orchard or an apple orchard. Okay. The starting pay for teachers is about $27,000 a year for someone who comes right out of college at the age of 22. And we have made it in the legislature possible for a teacher to be able to work, retire, and be able to come back, draw full payment benefits. They can be making up to $80,000 a year if they've got all the certifications and stuff that they asked for or that they can qualify for. I love my teachers. I loved my teachers. My first grade teacher was Audrey Garrett. Audrey Garrett School. My seventh grade teacher was Elizabeth Wood. She taught me how to diagram sentences and how to spell. And my last name is Allred, not Aldred. Now, you can call this whatever it is. I know, you know, some people, I want to set the record straight before I leave tonight on one thing, on a personal note, if I may.
Well, we're on the budget now.
All right.
Okay, you need to be discussing the budget,
okay.
Mr. Allred.
I'm telling you, the budget is too much.
Okay.
You started out with too much. You allowed the tax rate to get too high. There are too many administrators in the school system. We have too many sheriff's deputies. And we have too many people in the recreation department. And once again, I've complained about it for 3 or 4 months now. They go out and lock the gate at Altamaha Hall Beach State Park in Glencoe and, you know, lock the gate instead of putting up a sign that says park open from sun up till sundown. You don't need to be paying personnel to go out there and lock the gate and change the hours of operation every time you turn around. Use some common sense. Operate like a small business. We are struggling, people in small business. I'm fortunate. I'm 63. I'm able to draw Social Security. I've saved my money. I never made a lot of money, but I saved my money. Like a little old school teacher. You know, every now and then you hear about a little old school teacher who saved up a couple $1 million and gave it as a gift to somebody. Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, I'm just telling you, don't listen to the people who are from inherited wealth, who don't care how much taxes they pay or how much property tax they pay. Listen to the little people, the people who really are paying for the government, and not, and don't listen to the people who are asking you to give them money so they can actually make more money.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anybody else? Yes, sir, if you'll come up and state your name, please.
He didn't spell shit's fine.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
My name is Enos McDonald, and Terry, I promise I won't embarrass you more than I have to. I work for the Alamance County Sheriff's Department, and I think it's important. You guys know me. I've known y'all for years. I think it's important that we put a face on the people you're talking about furloughing. Now, personally, I'm retired. I'm a retiree of this great state, and I get a huge retirement right. But anyway, I get a retirement from the state of North Carolina. Terry was good enough to hire me full-time with the sheriff's department when I couldn't talk my son out of going to college. Okay, so it's not like 3 days off is going to put me in the poorhouse by any means. But let me tell you something about some of these other people that are working with me. Professionals that are professionals working in the jail, working on the road, and working 2 and 3 jobs trying to make ends meet. Luckily, I don't have to do that. I'm fortunate. But there are people that work with me that are not that fortunate. If they're given 3 days off without pay, something's going to be undone. They're either not going to be able to pay their power bill, they're not going to be able to pay their gas bill or their mortgage, or their children are going to do without something that normally they would have. Just wanted to impress upon you how important it is not to put these people out of work for 3 days. They can't afford it, and neither can I, quite frankly. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else in here? You can't double dip.
Carry on.
Well,
that's right.
I'm sorry. Yeah, but he did.
I was speaking on the public comment
he
period.
He did public comments, too. I'm sorry. You, come on, I'll let you come up. You talk to me after. So.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am, if you'll give us
my
your name.
My name is Rebecca Grindstaff.
Okay.
I work with the Alamance County Department of Social Services.
Okay.
I'm a dedicated employee, and I just want to share how sad it is to say that we would be furloughed for 5 days. 5 days, I don't know what it means to you, but I can tell you what it means to my family. 5 days means a mortgage payment. 5 days means I can't pay daycare. 5 days means I can't buy 15 tanks of gas to get to work. 5 days means I can't buy a month's worth of groceries. and I could continue that on and on, or I can't pay my property taxes. That's what 5 days means to me. But you want to turn around and give me now, 3 bonus days. Bonus days, and I haven't had a cost of living in 3 years? And then you want to turn around and take 5 days of pay from me, but give me bonus days? I'm sorry to tell you, but you're not giving me anything. I'm sorry about the deficit in Alamance County, and I'm sorry about the misuse of funds, and I'm sorry for that. But I want to give back to this county, and I feel like I do every single day. That I wake up, that I go to work, that I respect this county, and I respect the leadership of this county by doing what I need to do, by taking care of myself and my family. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
My name is Eva Fulcher, and I, too, am an employee of the Department of Social Services. You are asking for county employees to take furlough days. The average income of a DSS employee is less than $40,000. That's a lot of money. That's about a 2% reduction in our salaries that none of us can afford. We all have mortgage payments, as Ms. Grindstaff said. We all have bills. We have children we have to take care of. And unfortunately, come July 1, the Food Nutrition Services guidelines are going to go up to 200% of the poverty level. You do realize that there will be DSS employees who will qualify for those benefits. And due to having to take the mandated furlough days, they will have to apply for those benefits. It's an unfortunate event. I don't know the answers as to how you can balance the budget. I say the half-cent sales tax increase hits everybody, rich and poor. I don't care if you spend a dollar, you're going to pay it. I don't have the answers. I admire you for what you do. But giving us furlough days is not the answer. Thank you.
You want to talk on the budget? Eddie's going to pump on the budget this time.
I sympathize with these people who have to take furlough. But let me tell you something. Got stuck up there. I'm on disability. 100%. Nothing. Got stuck up there. Hospital, my Medicare, they've cut it. I wound up 2 trips to the hospital. I think its bills have come in so far over $2,000 for my part. Well, in real life, you know, people, I am sorry about the bird blow, but in real life, it's hitting us all. It's not just them. They ain't give a raise in 2 years, and gosh knows what they'll do next. Well, it's an election year. We might get one next year. They might promise it so they can get some votes. But it's hard times, and basically one side, I'm sitting here as paying taxes and saying, don't take my money, and they're sitting here saying, take his money so you don't take our money. I know, you know, but they, if they would look at it, there's people a lot worse than me that's still having to pay. In other words, I do all right. I ain't going into what, you know, what for and with force of it, but I got everything pretty well straight. I kicked the bucket, double-edged, they took care of. But there is people that goes without medicine or goes without food. That's the choice they got. And they still, to keep their little house, to keep their independence and stay home. It'd be a heck of a lot better to give the house up and go on state, you know, on whatever. But they don't want to. And if I was to make it that long, which don't look like it, I wouldn't want to either. And I don't want to be mad at these people griping about the furlough, but they need to realize there's people hurting a whole lot worse, and a whole lot worse than they take. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? If not, I'm going to close the public hearing at this time. Okay, next is a request of Alamance Broughton Board of Education on use of the...
I'm sorry.
Do we want to vote on this, ma'am? I'm sorry. I'm trying to get the cart before the horse. Okay, do I hear motion?
Well, I'd like to.
Oh, okay.
Can we talk about it?
Sure.
A little bit.
Sure. Ms. Donovan's to talk about it.
Man, I'm not trying to rush it.
That's okay. Go right ahead.
And hopefully we can get just a small amount of dialogue from Ms. Gant or anybody in relating to the school system to possibly give me some exchange on this. What I want to reveal here tonight. I didn't have to do a lot of research to do this. I mean, I've got three school systems with what's on DPI's own website as we speak. And we often equate money with success. Money with how much interest we have in our school system. I mean, if we don't put in more money, we don't have the interest that we should have, so forth and so on. And we often point to Guilford County, the supplement. Per pupil spending is what, roughly $1,000 per pupil higher than ours. If you look at DPI's website, and I had a guy from the balcony several years ago, said, well, why don't you talk about the lower grades instead of the high schools? And I made the comment, well, the high schools were the finished product. And I still believe that. But in trying to pay attention to what he did request from the balcony that night, I did go back and look at grades 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then, of course, the 10 end of grade into course test in the high school range. In Guilford County, where the money tends to be more progressive, as we might say, or some might say, in grades 3 through 8, there are 14 test, end of grade test, 14. And only 3 of the 14 does the district of Guilford exceed the state average. Only 3. That's stunning if you want to equate money with success. In the high school range, where there's 10, Zero out of 10 do they exceed state averages. They were called before Judge Manning, if I'm not mistaken, along with Forsyth and Durham, as having to do something quick to get their grades up. If you come over to... Well, let me give you our report. In grades 3 through 8, 5 of the 14 in grades 3 through 8 do we exceed state, according to what's on DPI. I'm not talking about what's done now. All I can do is go on what is on DPI's, because I look at the other systems as well. In high school, we only exceed 3 out of 10, the state average. Okay? So we're doing better than Guilford. If you want to look at those two comparisons alone, in my opinion. Money hadn't done it in Guilford. You come over and you look at Davidson, which is socioeconomically, I don't think Davidson's better off than we are. I wouldn't think their student body is better off than ours. I wouldn't think they're smarter. I wouldn't think they come from better homes. And I definitely don't think socioeconomically they're any better off. In grades 3 through 8, and they're definitely funded per pupil lower than ours. Definitely. 3 through 8, 14 out of 14. Out of 14 matchups, they exceed the state average in all 14. High school, 10 out of 10. They exceed the state average in 10 out of 10. Now, that's got to mean something, because there's definitely a money link there per pupil. They're not on opposite ends of the United States. And I would say Guilford's socioeconomic condition, I'm over there, I know. I go in their high schools. I see the homes they come from. Socioeconomically, Guilford's way better off than either us or Davidson. But their butts are getting kicked. So where am I missing the boat on the per pupil, the money being funded per pupil with these comparisons? Am I missing something? I mean, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic here, but it and I don't think I am. I mean, when you've got 14 out of 14, 10 out of 10 at Davidson, and you come over and you look at Guilford, if you just want to exclude Alamance, and come over and look at Guilford, 3 out of 14, 0 out of 10, I don't understand the money link. I don't think it is money. I think it's more than just money. So that's, you got, and I'm not trying to evoke a debate here. I'm just...
Well, I'll respond by saying that you're referring to test scoring, and my knowledge is not on those tests. I have to defer to the school system. And I understand your question to be, you're saying that because they, quote unquote, invest more on a pure pupil expenditure line, is what you're asking, is then why aren't our test scores higher? And again,
why aren't theirs higher?
Oh, you mean Guilford?
Yeah.
You know, I'm not a classroom teacher, so I'm not able to speak to that because I don't teach these children every day. Okay. I have looked at the information you're talking about, and I do understand there are great differences across the state on those counties that invest in education per pupil expenditure. Obviously, we've heard you state before that the responsibility of this commission is to uphold the facilities and its buildings. And most of the money that comes to the school, the majority of the money that comes to the school system from the state does support teacher salaries. I'm not able to answer your question on the link of money and test scores because that's not my expertise, but I'm sure if someone here in the facility has that knowledge, they would probably share that with you. Yeah. I don't know that it's necessarily a link between money and success. I think you have to boil it down to looking at to the types of students that you're working with. I think you have to look at class size. I think you have to look at the actual facility and what does it offer to each student. So I think you have to look at all the comparisons and not just the money issue. I have sat in multiple school board meetings recently, and I know that the school system has two very large notebooks of desires and wishes per se, or needs for their school that they cannot fund. I have not physically taken a look at that information, and I'm sure some of that would be necessary in teaching our students today, but I can't speak to that directly. But just knowing my knowledge and trying to attempt to answer your question, unfortunately I'm not the expert on that, but I do think it boils down to more than just the money factor, as you probably believe it does as well. But I firmly believe that our teachers are working as practically as, I know they're working as hard as they can with the resources they have, just like every other department in this county is doing the very best it can do in this very challenging economic situation. And I think that your commission has a very difficult position, and I'll defer to anyone in the school system who might be able to answer that for you.
I am a classroom teacher. I teach fourth grade, and I also have a very good friend who teaches in Guilford County in third grade, so we both have done the end of grade testing. Your comparison is comparing apples to oranges. The clientele in Alamance County versus Guilford County are two completely different groups of children. My children have completely different needs. They have different backgrounds than those children. When I was charged this year as a first-year teacher with teaching 29 fourth graders, 29 in a classroom setting with no assistant, no help all day long, just myself. So if I'm not able to get the financial help, if I can't get the manpower, the extra warm body next to me each day, I need something else. And having that technology piece, having the financial means to help those kids is what helped me get through this first year. As being 22 years old, talking about coming out, being a 22-year-old teacher and being charged with teaching these children. And I'd like to say that through the use of technology that every single child in fourth grade passed math and only five did not pass reading on the end of grade test.
What's your name, ma'am?
White Carter. like the color.
Okay, thank you.
Let me go on and get away from the schools, if you don't mind.
Okay, go ahead.
It's not the only concern ahead.
I'm sorry, just one demographic comparison, and I don't know that a study's been done on this, but you compare Alamance a lot to Davidson County, and you do it based on the comparable size of the student population. But please remember that Davidson County does not include the city of Lexington.
I understand.
Does not include the city of Thomasville. There's three school systems in Davidson County.
Yeah.
Well, I think we need to probably, if we're going to keep on comparing Alamance and Davidson, we probably need to do a study on largely rural versus non-rural school systems. If we're really going to be fair when we talk about funding and we talk about...
Well, I understand that, but with all due respect, when Davidson County is 14 out of 14, 10 out of 10, even the demographic variable doesn't justify that, in my opinion. Not the way I would look at it. I understand what you're saying, but I believe that wouldn't close the gap to understand that difference.
Are you going to take comments from
no,
the
sir.
Audience
no, sir.
When
no,
they
sir.
Disagree with something that's said?
No, we're fine. Okay. He asked for them, okay?
Yeah.
He asked for them. Okay.
Okay, now.
Okay, Mr. Sutton.
To get down to the actual budget, I mean, if we think this year's a doozy, how about next year? You know, 2010-11 and 11-12. I mean, I don't think it's going to change overnight at all. And we've got to have a mindset that we have got to do better than we've even done this year. And what I would point out would be, I've brought it up before, I'm going to go from Davidson and go to Randolph. Randolph is showing 730 total employees. We're showing 996. That's quite a difference. Now, granted, it's not a perfect apples to apples, but doggone, it's fruit to fruit. Their budget is like $18 million lower than ours. Now, granted, I don't think we have a recreation department. So there are differences. But we have got to figure out how to do it better, how to do it cheaper, how to do it more efficient. Because I'm telling you, if we bankrupt America any further than we're bankrupting, and this county is part of it, of the 3,000 and some counties in this country, nobody's going to have anything. Nobody. Everybody's going to have to work even harder with less pay. They're predicting that this generation that we're in is the first generation, or that's coming, my son's generation, is going to be the first generation to have to accept a lower standard of living than what their parents had. The first one. I'm not proud of that as a citizen. I'm not proud of that as somebody who's got an ability to take a vote on a budget. If you really care about all the agencies the government has to have, schools all the way, sheriff's department, all the departments, if we really care about it being a desirable job, a rewarding job, we've got to do better. And I suggest that after tonight, and we get the fiscal year going, July 1st, that we start immediately planning for the next fiscal year as to how we're going to do it without a tax increase, with lower taxes per $100 if possible, lower sales taxes if possible. We just can't keep going up on taxes. But that's it. I'm through.
Anybody else have any questions or comments?
Well, I want to make a comment to Tim for Randolph County. I had Craig had pulled this up earlier. Their tax rate is 0.555, which is higher than ours. Evidently, they pay their people more money or something.
I don't think that's the issue.
I don't know. Maybe they do.
They're in a different. What evaluation cycle are they in to start with?
Not sure.
Well, see, if we don't know those things, it's hard to get out there and shoot from the hip if you ain't got a target. We just got through reevaluation, and it's my understanding they're in a different cycle than we're in. And
they also passed quarter cent sales tax, too.
They did, but what they did, they told the truth about it when they tried to solicit for it. They told the public that, because I was shocked when it was approved, they told the public that we'll give this money to the community colleges. Cut and dry. Might not have been on the ballot, but that's what they told their electorate down there. Now, their electorate believed them. because I think they are an honest board. And the public voted for it because they said, okay, you're going to give it to the community college? We'll approve it. We're going to vote for it. Majority did. It wasn't a... I guarantee you, if you put a sales tax referendum out there at Randolph County and said it was going into general fund, in essence, a tax increase, and that we're not going to cut property taxes back the same amount, I bet you $1,000 it would have ever been approved. But they were honest about the purpose.
Okay. I have one thing to say. You know, when we lowered the taxes from 58 cents down to 52 cents, we thought we were doing revenue neutral, and we were 3 cents under revenue neutral. Is that right, Amy?
Two and a quarter cents
under revenue neutral. Now, we're trying our best not to have to increase that again. I don't like high taxes. I pay taxes, too. And I'm like Eddie. I'm retired. I draw Social Security. So I don't like high taxes either. But sometimes you got to bite a bullet. And that's why I think that the quarter-cent sales tax that we're going to talk about is better than raising your property tax. And we did go lower than the revenue neutral, and that was our mistake. And now we're having to eat it, and that's part of the problem right now. We're having to eat that 2 1/4 that we went under revenue neutral. So that's just my consensus on it.
Madam Chair, I'd like to respond to Lash's comment there about the doing the windows and so forth. And, you know, I didn't really realize this myself until I got on this board. There are so many stipulations. The government has to bid out stuff. We got a project tonight. One guy bid it. He's sitting right there, I guess, because I saw the name of the company on it. We've got builders in this county that are looking for work. I even had Tim and some of them come to the home builders to get them on the list, but they're still not bidding on the jobs. And I don't understand it, why they're not. And I agree with you, we could possibly do some of that in-house, but now there are certain stipulations, and correct me, Tim, if not, we do have to have a licensed architect to oversee the project. Is that correct?
Yes, you'd have to have a licensed architect or a licensed engineer if it's over a certain dollar threshold, and there's some other stipulations.
You don't have to get one from Durham.
Well, that was done before I got here, so I didn't have a...
They were put out for bids.
Yeah, they were. The architect was not.
The bid went out.
Not for an architect.
Mr. Burgess, did the bid go out?
Not on the architect. Right. You do not have to. You do not have
I'm not
going to
get in there.
No, but you do
that
not
was
have
before
to.
My time. I'm sorry. you're not
required by state statute to bid out architectural engineering
Okay.
But the key on the architect was he had expertise with courthouse-type renovations. Is that not correct?
Based on the prior experience that we had with them, that's why we recommended to the board to do it.
We need to get back on the budget, okay? Let's get back on
it. Well, it's part of the budget.
I know. Part of the story.
Yeah. That's why we are today.
Let's tell them
where we are because we had so much of a capital debt to pay for today. And that's a big part of it that was neglect over the years. So.
Well, let's get on with it. So. All right, are we ready to take a vote on the budget at this point? And if so, I will entertain a motion.
Is this just on the budget, not the sales tax?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I make a motion. We accept what's been presented from the county manager.
All right, I have a motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Is that a...
Aye.
You were opposed?
No.
Oh, okay. All in favor, okay. Everything is in favor. We do accept the budget.
Yeah. I was facing this way when I said that. I didn't hear you.
Okay. Next on here is the request of Almetsburg Board of Education on use of ADM funds. Mr. Hancock.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As we talked about as part of the budget presentation, we received a letter from the superintendent on May 25th. Kind of outlining issues of how that they would like to use some of the ADM funds this year, how they'd like us to budget $400,000 for them to use ADM funds next year. Also that they were going to allow us to use $1.7 million in interest from the bonds for our budget. And also
I think that in using the lottery funds of an additional million instead of using ADM funds. And with the board's approval, we do have to jointly approve of use of the ADM funds, and we will fill out the application and based on the letter that was submitted.
Any questions on that? Do I hear a motion that we accept this?
Make a motion that we accept it.
Request. Have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. That was, now we're going to talk about the 0.25% sales tax referendum resolution.
And Madam Chair, before we go into that, there needs to be a correction on this piece of paper that we've done today. The date that it's on there, May 17th, is not the correct date. I don't know if everybody noticed that. Thanks to Thomas.
Madam Chair, I have a question. I'm sorry. Is it 0.25% or 0.25%?
0.25%. Not 0.25%.
The rate is we're asking for is 0.25%. In other words, if you go to McDonald's and buy this drink, you're going to actually pay $1.08 for it, which I did today, by the way. I don't know where the quarter went.
They rounded up, I think.
They always round it up.
They do. They round it up anyway to 8 cents.
I know they do.
Yep.
Go ahead. Anyhow, I will read this out for us. Resolution by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners stating the intended uses of the 2007 0.25% sales tax revenue if the advisory referendum for the levy of a local sales tax passes by majority vote. Whereas in 2007 legislative session, the North Carolina General Assembly enacted State Appropriation Act, House Bill 1473, amending Article 46 of Chapter 105 of the North Carolina General Statutes. And it give us the option in this bill to either enact a sale transfer tax on property or to enact a 0.25% sales tax, okay? And this fund would come back to the county, this 0.25%. This we will have to pass as a board. I'm going to shorten it instead of reading verbatim. The House Bill 1473 provides that county commissioners could not levy a local sales tax unless a majority of the citizens voting in a special election or an election of this tax passes. And we have to vote on this tonight to put it on as a referendum for the November election. And just a point of comment on that, and I think Craig put everybody a sheet on there from the Association of County Commissioners. If this act is passed by us as a board and later passed as a referendum by the general public, then this tax would actually not be able to take place till next July.
I'd like to make a motion that's germane to this, please.
Can you hold on to Higgins?
I'd like to make a motion
through
as soon as he's through germane to his presentation.
So in order to follow through on this, we will have to either vote for it or not vote for it or whatever tonight.
Good. Now I'd like to make a motion that we have a public hearing in regards to this issue before we have a vote. Orange County, of all people, is considering the same sales tax referendum, and they're at least having a public hearing, and I think we should do the same.
I'll second that motion.
I have a motion and a second.
The people need to find out what's going on.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Aye. We will now go to the, do I hear a motion that we put this 0.25% sales tax out as a referendum for next year?
I would like to ask a question in regards to the motion. Are you willing to state in or amend your motion that you would roll back property tax as a commissioner the same amount as the new revenue that would come in? The $2 million comes in from the sales tax. Are you willing to roll back property tax $2 million, 2 cents?
That'll be up to the next
year's
board.
Are you willing to? Yeah. You're not.
What do you mean?
Are you willing to roll back property taxes, the amount of the sales tax revenue? In other words, if it brings in to me, and are you willing to tell the public, as Randolph County did, that you will roll back property? They didn't, that Randolph County had it part of their proposal, but at least they told the public the truth. Are you willing to say that you would roll property tax back 2 cents to offset the two million coming in from sales tax to make it a wash? Well, if you don't,
that's next July.
Well, is the purpose to raise taxes then? May I ask that? Is the purpose to raise taxes?
It is, to raise general revenue not only from property tax owners, but from the public in general. So what this is, an opportunity to take the full burden off of the property tax owners, which I understand where you are.
You never take the burden. I'm not going to be quiet. You never take the burden off the homeowners, because the damn government is going to keep spending money till they don't have money to spend. It's that simple.
The only thing I want is for the proponents of this referendum to be honest and say it's a tax increase.
It's a tax increase.
It is.
It's a tax increase.
It is a different source of revenue.
I hear you. Well, you said it's a tax increase.
I'm going to think when you get through.
Okay.
I'm asking you, do you consider it a tax increase?
It's a sales tax increase.
It's a tax increase.
No, it's
sales
a sales
tax increase.
It's a tax increase.
Sales tax increase. All right, let's all speak. And we do have a motion on the floor for the referendum, okay?
There is a motion.
There is a motion on the floor and a second. To put the referendum. Now, Ms. Vaughn, you want to speak before we vote?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Go right ahead.
There was an economist, John Gilbert, said, in economics, it is far, far wiser thing to be right than to be consistent. And with that, I'm going to add that I feel like there are cuts that we can make to the budget. And I'd like to address this gentleman right here from the Sheriff's Department. Would it be better to furlough part-time and contract people as opposed to across the board, all people, all employees?
You're asking me if I think it would be better to furlough them. I don't think you should furlough them.
It's working hard and trying to, you know, do what they're supposed to do.
I agree.
Well, I'm looking at core employees. That's what I'm looking at.
And I'm glad you called on me, because it gives me the opportunity to say something I forgot to say when I was up there. And I don't know what the dollar amount is. The man sitting behind me does. I don't know exactly how much the Sheriff's Department made for this county that went into your coffers to be used. I don't know what that figure is. But this man behind me could decide tomorrow that's over with. Understand that. He could say federal inmates will be out here next week, and so will the ICE inmates. He could do that because he has that power. And then what are you going to decide you're going to do next year when you're $6 to $13 million less than what you've got now?
That's right.
Who are you going to furlough then?
We need to get back to where we were.
Is that not the truth?
It don't matter. We need to get back where we are, okay?
All right. We know that the stimulus money or the windfall from the federal government will end this year. We know that. We also know there's going to be some problems as far as Medicaid is concerned, with money coming from the federal government, slice that with the state government, what's going to happen on the local level. I do believe that we must be proactive and not reactive. And for this reason, I'm going to vote for the 4% sales tax. I do know that if it passes this board, should it pass in November, that we do not have to enact it.
That's right.
Legally, we would not have to enact it, okay? I do know that maybe down the road we can, what's the word I want? do a resolution, I think, Clyde? Can we do a resolution down the road to repeal it?
It's an advisory referendum. And if the voters approve it, then the next board will vote on it.
Right.
May not pass the next board.
Right.
If it does pass the next board, there's no provision in the state law, in the statute itself, to repeal it. You'll find similar provisions to repeal in the vehicle rental tax and regional transit authority tax and the land transfer tax, but not in this one.
Okay.
And it can be. It says so you can.
Let me say one more thing about the County Commissioners Association. The 40-some counties, 100 counties have had the ability to do this. Only 40-some counties have done it, 40, 44. Some have done it multiple times, 59 attempts. It's only passed 15 times out of 59. And it's my understanding that the majority of the times that it's passed has been when they specifically said it was going for something, not going as a tax increase, nor that it was going in the general fund. It was specifically pointed out as to what it was going to be used for, and or it was at a time when it was a primary, when less people show out, or municipal election periods. So with all that said, the track record's not good for it to come back.
Someone said in our last meeting that you cannot escape the responsibility of tomorrow by evading it today.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second.
Should have George Washington.
I don't.
We have a motion and a second. Did you get a second? I'll second. Eddie made a motion.
I made the motion. I make a motion that we accept this resolution and put it on the ballot.
Okay. And I'll do a second on that. And all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay. It passes. We will put the resolution on. Okay. Next is Hall River Watershed Reclassification. Jason Martin, where are you?
I thought I'd prepare myself to come on up.
Thank you, dear.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening.
Is this short?
It's very short. I'll be very brief tonight. What you've got, you should have a memorandum from me kind of explaining this watershed reclassification.
Uh-huh.
The City of Greensboro put in an emergency intake on the Hall River on the Guilford County side that will be used, and our understanding is just in state of drought. But the North Carolina state law requires that when there's an intake put in, that reclassification of the watershed area has to be done. This reclassification being proposed by the state of North Carolina is to designate a small portion of Alamance County as a watershed 3, water supply watershed 3. Basically, you should have a map there. There's one that shows the entire watershed area that stretches all the way into Summerfield and Stokesdale. And then also a zoomed in version of just Alamance County, which is about a mile and a half, square miles, or close to 1,000 acres, between 950 and 1,000 acres. Basically, the water supply watershed, if it is created, we would have to look at amending our watershed protection ordinance and the watershed maps. It would essentially create a new watershed in the county. This, in addition to the Jordan watershed, which, as we know, covers 99% of the county.
Mm-hmm.
The proposal is affecting several local governments, including Rockingham County, Alamance County, Guilford County, Caswell County, Summerfield, Oak Ridge, several municipalities there, as well as the city of Reidsville. And they're all affected by varying degrees. Of course, the area for Alamance County is relatively small compared to Reidsville, Rockingham County, and a few others. The Planning Board on May 13th directed myself to work with my counterparts in the other counties and municipalities, to as well as the Council of Governments, to put together a response to the state. As of right now, they have not scheduled public hearings on this matter. They will have to do public hearings before they can create a new watershed area in the county. At this point, this is just so that you're informed of this coming, and I will keep you all informed, as well as the county manager, as I get more information.
Okay.
Once they establish a public hearing, I imagine it will be region-wide, probably in Reidsville or something like that. So,
so we don't need no action?
No action required tonight, just solely information.
Thank you much.
Thank you.
No problem.
All right, thank you. Next is to Mr. Williams. I think he needs to speak now, does he not? Matt, please come forward wherever you are.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Mac Williams, president of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce. And in keeping with the procedure that's been established by this body, I'm here tonight to ask for your decision to set the date of a public hearing for economic development incentives for LabCorp, who has a project that they would like to put into Alamance County. And I'd like to request that their date for their public hearing be set for Monday, June the 21st.
And you want to give any more specifics or just for the public hearing?
I think the procedure calls for me to tell you who it is.
The
fine-tuning of the details, I'm sure they still have some things that are going on, but that night, representatives from LabCorp will be here to give a full accounting of the project and all the details about it. Obviously, also, there will be a required notice in the newspapers announcing the public hearing itself.
Okay.
Is Burlington being requested to do the same?
As far as I know, yes, sir.
It's my understanding that there's no jobs involved here. Is that can you talk about that, or is it just building value?
I don't have the details about that tonight. And normally these kinds of things, 2 weeks is a long time, and a lot of things can happen in 2 weeks. And that is why I'm preferring not to let them tell you about the job issue as opposed to me tonight, because it could change in 2 weeks.
But you know.
No, sir, I don't know.
They haven't told you?
No, sir.
That's not my understanding, so forgive me.
Well, I've not been told about job numbers by the company. My role was to ask for there to be a public hearing set for June 21st, which I hope you would be willing to do.
Okay.
I'll make a motion. We have that hearing.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. I'll ask them.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Next is county manager reports.
No reports tonight.
Okay. Does anyone want to pull anything on the consent agenda? Better hurry. If not, do I?
Well, one thing on F there, the thing with Cobb Ezekiel.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Contract.
I don't know that I need to pull. I just got a question about that I had in budget hearing. Was that ever put out to have other firms a bid on that as a?
It was. It has not been yet, Mr. Boswell, because that takes about 3 months.
Okay.
So we are planning to do that for next fiscal year, but it was kind of too late this year.
Okay.
So.
I mean, I know we had talked about it earlier, and I just had that question about not that I disagree with them doing it. I think they did a fine job.
Okay, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
Have a motion?
Second.
2 seconds. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay, commissioner comments?
I got a comment.
All righty.
I hope the American people, especially the ones that live in Alamance County, will find enough energy to get out and vote against this tax increase, because that's what it is. It's a tax increase.
Well, the red herring was removed with that admission.
Well, I'll give up my hamburger for a week or so just to pay my 4% sales tax. So.
Yeah.
That's my comment on it. If it'll help Alamance County, I will do without my hamburger.
The revenue's got to come from somewhere.
Well, look at all the years that we didn't need.
Just yeah, but we do need. Well,
in fact, that brings up a good
yeah,
point.
We do. Okay. Any announcements? Other than. If not, we are adjourned.
Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.